Now you've come here for the 2021 Best Food Plot Mix video. And along with that, I'm gonna talk about what we're doing on our farm and the different locations that I'm hunting and planting food plots on, and try to relate that back to you, because just because I'm doing something a certain way or planting a certain mix doesn't mean you should. And there might be some other things that would be better for you. And I'm gonna talk about some of those recommendations and as it relates to what I'm doing, even with this plot right here. You know, I just very briefly, I urge you to check out my food plot web class. Link is in the description. What I do is design food plot programs for clients. That's part of what I do. I design their property, their hunt, stand locations, everything. But with that, with the 1,100 clients that I've seen in 26 states, over 100 a year, at least the last several years, I'm talking to those clients for about 2 hours each visit. At least we go into great detail of not only what they should plant, but what have they planted in the past, what's worked, what are their neighbors planting, what kind of resources they have for planting, what kind of planting equipment, what size plots are we going to be looking at. And so when I'm looking at, I'm taking in, you know, 12, 15, 20 variables that are always changing. It's like a giant puzzle. And then at the end of the day, I'm recommending what they should plant based on all of those factors. And so there's a lot of variety that comes into it. And what I've learned by analyzing 1,100 food plot programs around the country is that flexibility is key, and there's no certain one way to skin a cat. I'm gonna tell you what we're doing on this plot right here is how I've started many plots. I call it my easy no-till recipe. You can look that up and find that in our food plot section, or just type in easy no-till food plots and mine will come up at the top on YouTube, like a search function for my videos. But this plot right here is going to be a hunting plot. We've started these plots along with two other ones on this property. I would estimate this is about a half acre. We have a 1 acre plot over here, and we have a 2.5 acre plot in the back. They were all started by coming through here with glyphosate and 2,4-D and killing this, and it's been killed now 3 times, and this is about ready to plant. We're getting into early August or early July right now, and by early August we'll have this planted. I've been spraying this, and what it does, you can see here, is it opens up the soil. So what's nice about that, there's a lot of food plot seed varieties that I can throw right on the soil and grow. Buckwheat isn't one of them. We're using the Ultimate No-Till, my Ultimate No-Till plan on several plots out here. But for these first year plots, this is new parcel right here, I'm spraying, killing. And it might be that you can't manage planting the buckwheat during the summertime. It might be you don't have the resources for it. You don't want to spend the money and just plow it down or plant into it 2 months later. You know, a lot of people can't do that. In this location right here, we're spraying. On half of this plot, I'm going to plant a brassica blend. I use John Comp's Sweet Feast Brassica Blend. I've been working with John since he started his business 9-10 years ago, and I've been using that brassica product consistently because there's no fillers in it, there's no waste, there's no ryegrass in it. They're not mixing wheat and rye with brassica. That's a very bad thing. Anytime you see a mix like that, run, because it's not a competent mix that people are putting together. One fights with the other. I mixed those varieties back in the early 2000s. Just trust me, 20 years ago, we figured out that wasn't a good idea, and we'll just leave it at that. Not to mention all the other food plot experience along the way. So we're putting a clean brassica blend, that Northwoods Whitetail Sweet Feast. And on the other side, in a plot like this, I really like using the WHS blend, where I'm using a little bit of soybeans, a little bit more of peas, and then light oats. But in a case like this, we don't have that standing buckwheat. We're not going to disc or till or plow this field ever. Let me repeat that. We're never going to plant this as far as disking, tilling, and plowing it first. We're never going to do that on these plots. We haven't done it on any of the plots. I haven't disc, till, plowed anything for many years, because you just don't have to. There's better ways. So in this case right here, we're putting a brassica blend on one half of this plot, and on the other half, I'm going to put a heavy mixture of peas, 100 pounds per acre. We'll get some pea growth. More is better when it comes to peas. A standalone pea planting is 300 pounds per acre. We're just putting 100 pounds. And then I'll use a light oat mixture with just 50 pounds of oats. I'm not using the beans, because even if we get them to germinate, there's such a chance of that root rotting out, being exposed to the sun, drying out, dying. And so beans are not appropriate, even late planted beans around early August, like we would into the food plots where we have the standing buckwheat we can seed into and smash it over. Very simple process. Just spraying this, I mean, spraying this plot right here. And we actually have a bank of switchgrass back here we've done the same thing with, but spraying this plot out here and the time it takes to spray, I'm in here, in and out of here in 10 minutes at the most. It doesn't take very long, opens up the soil. We're just throwing the brassica on one side, and that'll grow great. I've been doing that for 20 years, over 20 years. And on that side, we're using heavy peas, 100 pounds per acre, 50 pounds of oats, and then I'll top dress that with 200 pounds of winter rye around Labor Day weekend. That's approximately 4 to 5 weeks after the initial seeding. And that's gonna be that green cover crop that lasts all the way till spring. So great diversity right here. What we're not planting here is, say, a bean field. That'd be horrible. It'd be down to the dirt already because it's so small, and it wouldn't offer anything appreciable going into the fall, so it'd be an expensive lesson of what not to plant. Now corn, I have corn out here. I have on 5 plots totaling about 6 acres of corn in total, but they're complementing the big food plots. Even the 1 acre plot over here, it's possible I'll put corn on that in the future if we expand it a little bit, but for the most part that's going to remain in greens, and it'll do the same green blend over the here as I am right here. I really want to get up to a point where on a plot system, if it has enough greens to last the entire hunting season, then you think about adding corn in addition to that. And so on these larger plots, we're going to have an acre plus of greens on each one of them that'll last in through the entire hunting season, and the corn is an outstanding complement to that. But on a plot this small, corn would not be appropriate either, just like beans wouldn't be appropriate. We're not trying to build a herd or anything here. This is in an ag area, so there's a lot of deer around here. We don't need to put deer here during the summer. I want them feeding out on these professionally manicured ag fields out here. And even if we were up north, the deer don't need the food during the summer because there's 5 times more food in a UP of Michigan, northern Minnesota, upstate New York, North Dakota, South Dakota area, big wooded area, even big wooded areas of Pennsylvania, Kentucky, West Virginia. There's a lot more food during the summer than the deer can even consume. And so in that case, we don't need that summer food unless we're really trying to establish a pattern of use on those plots. And so beans wouldn't be appropriate, corn wouldn't be inappropriate. And when you get up into some of the northern areas, a plot like this, if you don't have that complement of ag land and you're just in the woods and your food plot is going to be the source of high quality food in the fall, you might find that even brassica in a case like that won't make it till October 1st, October 15th. It's gonna be eaten down. Brassica is browse tolerant. It's better than soybeans, for example, better than sugar beets, for example, but a brassica blend still can't take a lot of grazing pressure. And if you're in an up north setting where your food is it and the best, then I look at layering rye. So the third week of August in northern Minnesota, I'd add 100 pounds of rye. 3 weeks later, I'd add another 100 pounds of rye. 3 weeks after that, another 100 pounds. You can create these food plots the same way. You're opening it up. You're making sure you take care of weeds. And let's face it, when we have small food plots like this, we can't afford to have those weeds diminish the overall volume of our plots going into the fall. Think about it, if you have 50% weeds in your plot, you're probably gonna have about 10% volume of your targeted seed, and those weeds all die in August and September, and you're left with just 10% volume of food source on a half acre plot, and it's going to amount to nothing for the local deer herd and certainly your hunt or your ability to build a hunt. So this little plot right here, we've sprayed 3 times, starting at spring green up when the weeds were 8 to 10 inches high. When we get into that early August timeframe, if there's still a few weeds out here, then I will spray again because weeds are the death of all food plots. I had someone the other day say, I don't use chemicals, I use rain. Well, that's kind of silly because the more rain you have, the more weeds you have. You know, if you are taking care of small plots like this, you just don't have room to waste. And even if you have 10 acres of food plots, you can't afford to be wasteful and end up only having 10% of your forage that you're intending on having just because you didn't take care of it, didn't take care of the weeds. So in this case right here, this small little plot, it'll be easy to plant. We're just gonna use the easy no-till process. Again, brassica blend on this side, 100 pounds of peas, 50 pounds of oats on the other side. We'll top dress that with 200 pounds of winter rye around Labor Day. This is all early August planting except for the rye. And then on this side, if there's a brassica failure due to drought like we had in Wisconsin last year, is the first time that we had a drought-related failure for brassica since 2002 planting down here in Wisconsin. So it really doesn't happen very often, and it's actually my first brassica crop failure since 1998 due to drought or anything else other than deer overbrowsing. So if we have an overbrowsing or a drought issue, I don't suspect we'll have overbrowsing, then if the brassica destroyed, I'll add that 200 pounds of winter rye on that half too. So let's go on to some of our other food plots. I hope that makes some sense. You can at least relate this to this as something you might be doing. If you have that high browse level on your food plot, then consider layering rye. You could even start with that oat and pea mix to begin with, and then top dress it with 100 pounds of rye 2 weeks later, and then another 100 pounds after that, maybe even 200 pounds. If you're pushing back the timing to where it's more like October 1st in Michigan, even down into southern Ohio over to Kentucky, Tennessee, always consider around October 1st. If you're late to the game, then spread 300 pounds of winter rye right on the top of it so you can enjoy a low, lush green stand. Again, we're not harvesting seed, so putting a seed that'll compete with each other for the following year for production doesn't have anything to do with food plotting. Food plotting's not farming, farming's not food plotting. And let's go take a look at some of our other plots and hopefully you can apply some of that to your own land as well. Now this plot right here is really a melting pot for a lot of our food plot plantings and the mix that we're using this year and several different ways to get that mix to happen. You'll see we have corn back here. So this plot right here is about 2 acres, 2.25 acres. And so we have enough room for an acre of corn. And I want to get that at least that amount in order to make that corn appreciable. So Brandon from First Choice Food Plots planted that. And I encourage you, if you have enough greens, the green blends that we talk about, the late planted brassicas, the peas, the beans, the oats, top dress with rye later. When we have those kind of combinations, if you have enough food, you have those greens, then the next step up is corn. And so that's why we're introducing corn. That's why we have corn on 5 plots out here. We have some machine planted buckwheat just because it was easier and he was here. And then we have the corn, but this is all broadcast. So you see all this buckwheat right here, everywhere. My buddy Mike Pratt and I, we just hand broadcasted this, roughly 50 pounds per acre. It's coming in great, very, very good. And the machine planted stuff, that was planted just a few days earlier into damp soil. So they got immediate germination where the broadcast had needed to get some moisture on it and some rain. When you drill and you push that seed down in there, it immediately germinates. But bottom line is we're not disking, tilling, plowing anything right here. We start by spraying this, getting it ready, and then we're looking at that fall crop. The reason for the buckwheat is, again, we will use the ultimate no-till buckwheat planting method that I originated early 2000s. And when this buckwheat, we really want to target this buckwheat on good soil for 6-7 weeks of growth, not 8-9 weeks. 8-9 weeks puts it up about chest high. It's hard to plant into. On good soil, we're looking at 6-7 weeks of growth, which will put us into that first week of August here. And then ideally it'd be waist high. It's easy to walk through and seed into. You seed the seed into the standing buckwheat, then we'll roll it over with a Packer Max, pulled behind the Kubota, ATV. I might even use a couple of them so we can get it done faster. And I found with many hands when it comes to food plotting, we have 15 acres out here to manage. Helps a lot. We can get a lot done just in a short amount of time. We have some more machines and more cul-de-packers and more seeders and more legs and hands to get everything accomplished. Once this buckwheat is up about waist high, it's that early August frame, then we can actually plant the seed right into the standing buckwheat. We'll crush it. And then I hate weeds because I want to be efficient with my plots. I can't afford to waste space. And so I spray this buckwheat when I'm done smashing it over, and that is critical for 2 reasons. One, any of these broadleaf weeds in here I want to kill. But 2, I want to kill the buckwheat and make sure it stays dead, because then it just lingers, it stays half alive, and it shades out your seed. It doesn't matter if it's big seeds like beans, peas, and oats that can go through a lot of thatch and have the ability to throw up a 2, 2.5, 3-inch leader and get through garbage. It'll still shade out that, let alone the little brassica and tiny seeds. So I want this to deteriorate quickly. And at the same time, I want that buckwheat to act like straw laying on top of the soil so that it holds moisture over the germinating seed and aids in germination, protects it. No different than putting straw in your grass. So that ultimate no-till planting, we're doing in early August. We put in 100 pounds of peas per acre, 50 pounds of beans, light mix of oats, and then we'll top dress that with 200 pounds of winter rye. That's what's going to go into half of this buckwheat. The other half we'll put our brassica blend. If the buckwheat's too tall, it gets chest, neck high for some of you out there, I encourage you to smash it down first, spray it, then apply your brassica blend so that you have an even coverage with your broadcasting rate. We can throw a brassica blend right on top of the soil and it's going to germinate. You'll have great success. So the buckwheat isn't necessary for the germination of the brassica like it is for the larger seeds like late planted beans, peas, and oats. But it aids in building the soil all summer long and acts as a smother crop to keep weeds at bay during the summer. So it limits the amount of herbicide you can use and it's building the soil. I would just, if that buckwheat is waist high, perfect, because you spread that seed out with a hand broadcaster, it's easy to get a good even coverage. If it's tall, it's not going out very far before it hits buckwheat and falls straight down. So we end up with stripes when we get really tall buckwheat. So that'll be corn on about 50% of this plot. And then on the other 50%, we're dividing it 25% with brassicas broadcast into the staining buckwheat. And then the other 25% of that leftover space, we're putting the WHS green blend from John Comp at Northwoods Whitetails, where we're putting the beans, peas, and oats, and then top dressing with rye later. You know, I've been playing around with these mixes for a long time. And, you know, the bottom line is you have to have that diversity. A lot of people look at diversity or just adding all those seeds together. You know, putting the brassica blend with oats, peas, beans, kitchen sink blend, that is very, very bad. It's not a competent seed blend that should be even sold, let alone put into your plots. The reason for that, the reason we separate these is I want to maximize the volume of the brassica in this location. I don't want it being fought with competition from rye and oats and wheat. And then I'm putting those peas and beans and rye and oats over on this side. I'm letting the peas and beans get a good start before I add the rye 4 to 5 weeks later, so that I'm maximizing the volume of two separate plantings in the same plot. Because we have enough room for green here, then we can just add the corn like we did. And so we have more, even more diversity in this location. Now I'll tell you what, with these two green blends right here, corn over here, most of the neighbors around here, they're using corn and bean plantings for food plots and they just can't compete. The green is necessary for these deer. They crave it. And it was critical last year. We noticed that during the winter, they hammered the corn when it was very cold. We had minus 30 degrees, under minus 30 degrees a few nights this past winter in January and February. And they were pounding the corn then because they needed those carbs to create energy to stay warm. As soon as it warmed up, guess where they were at? They're back on this brassica, on the greens, and then switching over to the rye back and forth. It was still green under the snow. And so they had all kinds of food from the end of August, September, October, all the way through March, April. And let's face it, that's the most critical time for deer anyways. They live high in the hog out here. They do anywhere in the north half of the country, except for the arid southwest regions like Texas. Just like we can't apply the other 25 whitetail states where you need more of a system like this to Texas, that one spot in Texas, areas of Oklahoma, arid portions down like that, what they do down here, we can't apply to the rest of the whitetail states. There's two different areas, and I recognize that. If I went down to Texas, we'd have to look at a different food plot program than what we're doing here, Arizona, and certainly Oklahoma in some locations. Not to mention differences in planting varieties. You know, again, if you're in a northern setting, you're going to And you don't have the support of ag around you, and you don't have a lot of food plot acres, and I'm talking 4 or 5 acres, you can have a very low number of deer in a spot like this. Instead of having corn, instead of having brassicas, you might look at more that straight rye, peas, oats, staying with the basics. And that's okay, because really, if you have appreciable green that lasts for the entire hunting season, then that allows you to be the herd influencer and actually build a great hunt, build a great herd. And it's all about bringing as much diversity as you can through the entire season. You know, really in most areas, if you have decent sized food plots, I'm talking, we use just 2.25 acres in Coon Valley, but we have the support of ag. That 2.5 acres in Coon Valley on 40 acres should translate into 5 or 6 acres in a northern setting, even if we have half as many deer or a third as many deer, just because there's going to be more browse pressure on those plots. In that case, we're focusing on in Coon Valley, I'm looking at 50% in brassicas, 50% in the WHS blend with rye, oats, and peas and beans. If that was the same food plot size in a northern setting without the complement of ag, I would recommend more of the layering where you have heavy, heavy peas, light oats, top dress it with rye. You can layer 100 pounds of rye, end of August, another 100 pounds, another 100 pounds. You're typically adding that 100 pounds roughly a month before your expected first frost date. In the UP of Michigan, that'd be early September, mid-September. So then you're backing up 4 weeks. You're adding that first layer of rye mid-August to the 20th of August, 100 pounds. So if you're first frost date is around October 1st, early October, then you're going to look at a Labor Day planting in some of the more southern areas like West Virginia, Tennessee, Kentucky, where you want green and you have a lot of woods, those deer are going to hammer it. But then I'd recommend a better diversity if you can actually withstand that grazing pressure. So 2021 best food plot mix, it really calls for being flexible and being diverse in your plantings. I've been planting strip plantings like this since the early 2000s and playing with mixtures, seeing what gets the best, because I get paid to be right. You know, like I said, I work with over 100 clients a year, at least 2 hours per day just spent on food plot time. You know, when we wrap up at the end, what should you plant? Interview time for a half hour, hour about their plots in the beginning of the day. That's about 25% of the entire day. Most of my days are about 10 and a half hours with clients. This is what works. You want to have this diversity. You want to make sure that deer are starting to focus on your food plots and your land in September, October, November, December. You have enough oomph and diversity and volume to carry it through. That might be just layered rye. It might be something like we do. You might be even trying to build a herd and you're adding and introducing soybeans during the summertime or a clover rotational program so you can actually build deer numbers. There's a time and a place for every seed variety. Out here, I don't plant soybeans just because I don't need to. The previous owner did for years. Most of their pictures were in velvet. They didn't have that ability to influence a herd or build a great hunt with just beans alone. They were down to the dirt by early October, not offering much. And so in 1 year, we were just one growing season, we were able to flip that around and really draw a lot of attention here during October, November, by offering this level of diversity. I could get beans for free. So if I thought it was good to plant them, I'd definitely be planting them. But they're just not appropriate for the majority of plantings. Corn isn't. We're using corn out here. I would say that probably 80% of you watching this, maybe even 90, corn is not appropriate for you. You have to fill that foundation, that food plot pyramid of the greens first, then the corn, and then summer forages if you're trying to build a herd. Other than that, you really need to focus on that green base. Corn won't be appropriate for a lot of you. Soybeans shouldn't be appropriate for a lot of you, regardless of whether I'm planting or not. And then even brassica. A lot of brassica blends work in southern Michigan, northern Ohio, northern Indiana, northern Illinois, southern Wisconsin, flat areas where you have a lot of ag. Sometimes you put a standalone brassica. If we just put this all in brassica right here, we might not have the deer because they're not establishing that pattern of use in August and September. We're expecting them to come in here at end of October and start hitting brassica. Well, if they're not establishing that fall pattern of use here, they're establishing it somewhere else. It might not be before January or February before they hit this brassica. It's after the season. It really didn't do them any good. And at the same time, those bucks are probably dead or gone somewhere else because we couldn't influence a herd at all. So it's always important. We've had some big failures even in southwest Wisconsin where we plant all brassica in one location. Well, that writes off that location and that 40 acres of use for that 2 1/4 acre plot. And those stands, those bedding areas, those movements, those water holes, those mock scrapes are not being used because the deer are elsewhere during that time. That's why I like stripping out these. I want to get the most volume on the brassica side. I want to get the most volume on the oats, peas, beans. Whatever you're doing, you want to make sure that it lasts, that you're matching to the needs of the deer. And it's critical. What's interesting, when you offer enough diversity and you're creating that food plot program that's based on diversity and volume, the most you can get for the fall, then you're helping the deer too, because the lowest hole in the bucket in the deer's world, deer don't starve in July, June, August, September. They starve in February and March and even April. So when you address those concerns of offering health there and that nutrition at that time, you're getting the most volume on your plots, then you're going to not only going to affect your ability to have a great hunt and influence the local deer herd, but you're going to actually be able to have an appreciable amount of health that you're adding to the deer and helping the health by giving them food at a time when they're not used to it. I encourage you again, you know, I have my food plot web class. I encourage you to check it out. There's 30 videos. This is just a portion of what we talk about in those videos, but there's 30 separate videos to help you make sure that taking the experience of those 1,100 clients in 26 states and what I do on a daily basis with my career and full-time profession, helping people out, whether it's you guys on YouTube or through my books, web classes, or client visits, infuse that into that web class so that you can be successful with the time and resources that you're spending for food. I can't stand some of the online information that you look at and people follow and you know they're going to fail. And it's disappointing because there's a lot of information out there is poor. We try to wade that through that for you. And for this 2021 food plot, best food plot mix, whether we're planting the easy no-till in areas and just three sprayings and a planting, and we're talking about those basic blends, or we're talking about layered rye in a northern setting, or we're actually getting a huge amount of diversity with the corn, the brassica, planting into this ultimate no-till blend with the standing buckwheat. If you look that up, there's a lot of supporting videos for that on YouTube. Just type in ultimate no-till food plots, buckwheat no-till food plots. All my stuff will come up at the top. I've been doing this for years. Those are methods that I came up with in the early 2000s. So a lot of years of practicing this and making sure it's done right for not only myself and what I love with whitetails and the passion for whitetail and hunting, but for my clients that I'm paid to actually offer accurate, good information on a monthly basis. So this year, great. Wish you great luck on your food plots. Make sure if you're hitting your food plots and you're spending the time, make sure you do it right. And I love hearing about it because we get a lot of feedback down below in those comments about people saying, I've been using these methods for years. It's changed the way we hunt. It's changed the way that we attract and hold deer and build a deer herd. So I love hearing that information. Leave your feedback down below. But most of all, have fun, enjoy doing this, enjoy being on a path that's in the right direction. And I hope you have a great hunt and the use of your entire land, including your food plots, this fall.